Good morning. Justin Bamberg, attorney with Bamberg Legal and state representative, and joined here with a wonderful family that is struggling through a very, very difficult time. And the purpose of today, where by now everybody in this community is aware that a very, very horrible tragedy took place right behind us. And that's where we're standing. Right behind us is where a beautiful person, beautiful young lady, beautiful daughter, beautiful granddaughter, beautiful friend, took her last breath. We've seen in these situations time and time again, there's an officer-involved incident. Families demand answers. They want to know what happened to their loved one. Communities demand answers. They want transparency from their government. And that's what today is about. And today is not an easy day, just like no day has been easy for this family. Mental health illness is a problem, an issue that the state, our citizens, families, people, law enforcement, that everyone has to care about. Long gone are the days where, unfortunately, in places all over this country, if someone had a mentally ill family member, they would tie them up under the house. We don't live in those times anymore. This young woman struggled with mental illness. She did. This family, these parents, this is her father, Troy. This is her mother, Maddie. And they tried everything they could to help a loving daughter who is struggling with mental illness. What happened that day, and we can ponder why, we can ask all the questions in the world, and it doesn't change the facts. First, I'd like to say thank you, to the Lawrence County Sheriff's Office, to the sheriff, and to SLED, because the family was afforded an opportunity on yesterday. They were given transparency. They were afforded an opportunity to see details about what happened to their loved one. And I can tell you, I've done, unfortunately, in the realm of civil rights, cases all over this country. And it's a rarity to get that from government. It's a rarity to get that from law enforcement. In Charlotte, Keith Scott, there wasn't that. The city of Charlotte was set on fire for 2 days before the public knew anything. And the information the public got came from the family. It came from government later. Same thing in Louisiana with Alton Sterling. Right. Walter Scott, and I represented the Scott family in Charleston. Law enforcement lied about what happened. And it wasn't until it was uncovered later through Faden Santana, that is how the truth came out. That is not the situation we deal with here. And there is a degree of closure and finality and peace that can be brought on a family when government, when law enforcement is transparent with them after a horrible situation happens. So what happened? What happened less than a week ago? What happened? There's a 911 call. The call was placed from the residence. It was Kayla. And this young woman, struggling with mental health, called 911 to report that the house was being burglarized. And who was the burglar? It was a person who didn't exist. And we had an opportunity to listen to the duration of that call. And it's heartbreaking to listen. She was calm, She was peaceful. She's just reporting a burglary. Somebody's broken into the house. Dispatch apparently relays that to law enforcement. They're on their way. And after about 7.5 minutes, the dispatcher tells this young woman, someone is almost there. And she hangs the phone up. The first officer to arrive on the scene was a canine officer with the Lawrence County Sheriff's Office. And it is what it is. The facts are what they are, okay? Kayla comes out and she's holding a long, sharp object in her hand. All right? And she's holding that. And she meets the officer. And this officer obviously draws her firearm and is saying, drop it, drop it, drop it. Kayla then grabs this. I'm going to talk more about this later. This is a problem, in my opinion. But she pulls out a projectile device that's manufactured, it's made, it's intended to look, feel, operate, and be perceived as a real-life firearm, a real-life handgun. But it doesn't shoot bullets, it shoots little projectile balls. But she pulls this out. And you see the officer, there's a canine in the car, the officer doesn't sick the dog on her or anything like that. The officer's telling her, drop it, drop it, drop it. And there's some back and forth. And as the officer moves from one position to cover to the other position to cover, Kayla still has these things in her hand. The officer puts the gun up, grabs the taser, attempts to taser. That's ineffective. It doesn't work. All right. Other officers arrive on scene. And at some point, another less than lethal force opportunity was taken, and Kayla was shot with less than lethal beanbag rounds. And there were four shots of that, four. And the fourth one knocks her to the ground. And an officer tries to get to her, but she ends up getting up. And when she gets up, she grabs those objects again. And she's yelling, kill me. She's yelling, kill me. And she ends up losing her life and taking her last breaths right behind us. And it's hard, all right? There are people who always want law enforcement to be wrong and the citizen to be right. There are people who always want law enforcement to be right and the citizen to be wrong. And I'm here today to tell you, to tell anybody that's watching, what matters is the truth. When these things happen and these families, this family has to deal with the loss of their loved one, they want the truth. Doesn't matter what people in the public want, those who have special interests, that doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what law enforcement wants, those who will do anything to protect the badge or to protect the thin blue line. No, what matters is the families that are impacted. And it starts with getting the truth. Closure comes with the truth, and the truth matters. Facts matter. And it's a horrible situation. The mental health system in this state let this family down. This young woman wasn't always suffering from mental illness. In approximately January of this year, her loving parents, her loving family, noticed that something was different. They noticed something was different, and they sought help. And they sought help on more than one occasion. And this young woman, this beautiful spirit, this beautiful person, she received some treatment. In fact, leading up to this, she was actually in the hospital receiving psychological mental health care up until May 12th. when she was discharged home. And unfortunately, when she was discharged home, nothing was explained to the parents. They're not mental health experts. They're loving parents who want to do the best they can with a situation that they are unfamiliar with. And they have been trying. Every gun that was in this house got put away so that this beautiful spirit, this beautiful person, wouldn't have access to it to potentially hurt herself. Every gun got put away. They watched her. They checked on her. They asked her about medication. Are you taking your medication? They did everything that they could. These parents did everything right. And the system let them down. Not a single professional explained to them, what do you have to watch out for when somebody in your family is struggling with schizophrenia? What do you have to watch out for? Are there things that you should vet? Are there specific things that you should look for? Nothing. Nothing was explained. In fact, she previously had a firearm. And guess what this loving family did? They took it to protect her from herself. She never threatened to hurt herself before or anything like that. But it was a precautionary measure. They removed the firearms. How is it then that she was able to obtain this? A Byrna. A Byrna is what it's called. Byrna. And it shoots like OC spray type projectiles. And it shoots these pellets. And this is marketed. This is marketed in such a way as to skip, like, hey, look, no license is required. Federal law doesn't apply because it's not a quote-unquote firearm. You don't have to take a class. It's marketed to encourage people to buy it who either can't. This young woman could not go buy a firearm if she wanted. She'd been committed before. She couldn't. But somehow she was able to get this. And this was designed to look, feel, operate, and intimidate people as though it is a real gun. It looks like a real gun. Literally. And she was able to obtain this, and that's how it's marketed. And I took the time last night. I'm a big Second Amendment person. I read through the owner's manuals for my firearms. Yeah, Springfield. Guess what it mentions in its manual? It mentions not intended for children or people who are mentally handicapped. These are what these manuals mention for firearms. You know what this one doesn't mention? Doesn't mention anything about mental health. It doesn't. There are no warnings at all. There is nothing for a device that looks and operates just like a real gun to tip off anybody that it's not safe for certain people. This is what we have to look at. The facts are the facts. And again, we appreciate the transparency displayed by the Lawrence County Sheriff, by SLED. It should be the standard, not the exception. And as we, again, I serve in the General Assembly, we're working to revise the current body camera statute. And as a part of that revision, we're going to try and amend that bill so that it doesn't have to be an optional thing. When the Lawrence County Sheriff or when SLED, as in this case, says, we're going to let the family watch it in private, or their representative watch it in private, so that these parents know what happened to their loved one. Shouldn't have to rely on it being optional. We want to put it in the law where it's mandatory. How do we fix this? Where do we go from here? Step one is making it mandatory that within 72 hours of an officer-involved incident, the families have to have the option of sitting down to review this stuff for themselves. We talk about protests and riots that we see all over the country. right? We talk about the relationship between law enforcement and citizens. And if we're ever going to fix it, it starts with complete transparency. First, with the families. That's where it starts. The second thing, where do we go from here? How do we can't change what happened behind us. We can't. But how can we try to prevent it in the future? Well, one way is addressing mental health in this state. And what we're going to work on is we're going to work on a plan. The system of 911 dispatch in this state is more high-tech and technical than it has ever been before. So here's the plan. Why don't we create a voluntary system where families like this, who aren't familiar with schizophrenia, who aren't familiar with paranoia, who aren't familiar with bipolarism, families like this who are trying their best, they can call their local 911 centers and they can say, I would like to voluntarily have my residence placed in your system on your registry as denoting we have someone struggling with mental illness living at our house. What change does that make? Well, when this dispatcher is on the phone talking to Kayla and she's reporting a burglary that actually isn't happening, as the dispatcher relays that to law enforcement in their system, it will show this is the address. This is the person living there with mental, oh, Kayla. She knows then, the dispatcher knows that she's on the phone with someone struggling with mental health. And that information can be relayed to law enforcement. These are ways that we can fix the problem, that we can address the inequalities that exist in this state as it pertains to mental health. So that is something that's going to be worked on. And we're going to try, with the community's support, with members of the South Carolina House and Senate, we're going to try to see if we can accomplish this. Yes, a voluntary registry. Another aspect of that registry will be, as with this family, their law enforcement had been here before. I believe it was a week before. A week before, law enforcement came here. Kayla called 911. And it was about her keys. Someone took her keys. Her keys were missing. And when law enforcement comes, this loving family shows the officer information. It was an officer with the Lawrence County Sheriff's Office. Shows them the information. She just got out of the hospital. She was committed for mental health. Here's the paperwork. Things like that could be denoted in these 911 dispatch centers. So that when law enforcement officers do respond, they know they're interacting with a mental health patient. We're trying to save lives of citizens, stave off pain and trauma that never goes away for families like this, and also help law enforcement. Because whichever officer was the one that pulled the trigger and unfortunately took this young lady's life, they got to live with that for the rest of theirs. I can't imagine how it feels to know that you're the person who killed someone who was sick and needed help. If you care about law enforcement, you should want this fixed too. It's not a citizen versus law enforcement. This is a cracks in system that need repairing. It's no different than a road we drive on to get to our destination. How long are we going to keep running over the crack? And every time you hit a crack, somebody dies. Somebody's life gets destroyed. We've got to address this stuff. We can't bring her back. But we can try to make sure that another family doesn't have to bury a loved one unnecessarily. So what I'm going to do at this point is turn it over to Troy. Beautiful spirit, this beautiful person's father.
How y'all doing? First, I want to thank the community and the outpouring of love and support for my daughter. I always wanted my daughter to be more than just a headline, more than just a hashtag. And she was a beautiful spirit. She was loving, she was kind. But my daughter was sick, and she needed help. The mental health system failed my daughter. We tried so much to get her help. We tried so many times to get her help. And I don't know, they just didn't help her. Not in the way that she needed. When she got out, we even made phone calls to MUSC, the psychiatrist, and told her she's still not herself. She's still not in her right mind. Had my daughter been helped, she probably would still be here today. But like I say, I want everyone to remember her as the beautiful, intelligent, educated, very well educated woman that she was. And know that we can't bring our daughter back, but our daughter's life can mean something. We can't look at the past. We gotta look at the future. We gotta look at families that are going through the same thing that we're going through, and don't have the resources, don't have the help, don't have the anyone advocating for them. So that's what I want my daughter to be remembered by. She took her last breath here, but she'll live forever.
What we'll do at this point, you're going to hear from Derek Quarles, who is a family friend. Derek.
Good morning. My name is Derek Quarles. I must say that as I stand with this family, today my heart aches for Kayla and her battle with mental illness that so many individuals live with in this country. The truth is, Kayla should still be alive today. Kayla's illness should not have been a death sentence. Rather, it should have been an opportunity for law enforcement and the mental health community to work collaboratively to establish protocols for how law enforcement interacts with individuals. None of us know what triggered Kayla. We've all seen too many accidents between mentally ill individuals and law enforcement that escalate simply because there were no established protocols on how to deal with someone who's calling for help, someone who is in a crisis. We need a system in place by which individuals who have been diagnosed with a mental illness can freely and voluntarily opt in to let law enforcement know that an individual has a history of mental illness, so that the response will be different. We need officers that are trained in mental health and de-escalation, and those are the ones that should arrive first to engage a person in a crisis. In 2017, a law was passed in South Carolina that requires every law enforcement officer to learn to spot mental illness when dealing with individuals who might be experiencing a crisis. The legislature passed this law, however, they provided no funding and provided no specification for how the training should be modeled. If we're going to fix what's truly broken, we must have all of the missing pieces. The failures of our mental health system cannot be overlooked. Mental health professionals should be working diligently with families like this one to make sure that individuals understand how to identify triggers or indications that their loved one might be headed into a crisis. It's not fair to release an individual from care or treatment facilities without adequately detailing mothers and fathers, sisters and brothers, and other relatives for how they should care for their loved one who is mentally ill. This family is committed to advocating and educating the community at large on best practices for mental health and law enforcement engagement. And we're supporting them through this potentially life-changing and life-saving efforts. Thank you.
All right, and we'll take some questions here in a second, but I do want to say one thing to the community. It's tough to see these things happen in your community, and it's tough for families to deal with. I mean, when you lose a loved one, whether or not a shooting is deemed constitutional under the law as it exists in this country or whether it's not, it's tough. And the pain is the same, regardless. I will say this, and again, this is not a family guessing, this is not a lawyer guessing. We had the opportunity to see this with our own eyes. And as much as it hurts this family, as much as it hurts me, Derek, friends, there's a degree of appreciation there for knowing what happened and not having to wait forever to get the answers. One thing that I saw was after the shooting happened, the deputies approached Kayla. And we've seen time and time again, I think back to, for example, Alton Sterling. When he was shot in Baton Rouge in front of the Triple S Market, and I had to watch those body camera videos, and not a single officer lifted a finger to help that man after he was shot. In fact, the officer who did it said, "F it, leave him." And there is a degree of appreciation that even after a horrible situation, and we wish they hadn't shot. Make no doubt about that. We wish they hadn't. But after they did, they tried to help her. And they didn't take time to put gloves on, rubber gloves. They didn't take time to do it. They instantly went and tried to help this young woman. And law enforcement needs to understand, like those officers apparently did, is that even if you pull the trigger, it doesn't mean you have to sit there and wait and let them die. You can try to save their life. And that's what every law enforcement officer in this state should do if they use force, is try to then save the life. Try to save life. You're not here to take life, you're here to save life. So at this point, happy to take any questions that y'all may have, if anybody has any.
Yeah, I had a question. Before everyone saw this body cam footage, having to wait even a couple of days, what mm-hmm. was going through everyone's mind before actually being able to see what unfolded here?
I mean, the same thing that normally does in these situations. It's, why? What happened? It's rumors. It's who did it. It's what were the circumstances. Troy, why is my daughter gone? Will someone tell me? Right? Those are the things, pain, hurt, confusion. You know, why? What? Just, they want to know what happened. You know, in those days, maybe days on a calendar, but it's an eternity to a family in pain. And that's why we say that a situation like this, in terms of a family's ability to get certain information, right? And yeah, there are investigations. The investigation is still underway, right? SLED still has a job to do, right? And I trust that they'll do it. And we expect them to do it. But it's not fair to families when they have to wait, right? They have to wait either months, sometimes years, or it's released to the public first and they have to see it on social media and in the news. The standard in this state, when these things happen between citizens and law enforcement, the standard should be the family within 72 hours, 48 hours, as soon as feasibly possible, they should be able to see what happened. Because that brings, and guess what? If Michael Slager goes and shoots Walter Scott in the back from 100 feet away, it shouldn't be a secret. The family should be able to see that so they know timely what happened to their loved one. They shouldn't have to rely on a ram in the bush, a witness like Faden Santana who recorded it, right? And it can't just be situations where some like this, where someone is holding what looks to be a real gun or holding an object or something like that. It shouldn't just be in that situation, right? We can't pick and choose when a family should be able to see these things timely and when they shouldn't. The standard in this state should be always, because the facts are always the facts. And that is what we want to see removed from the equation in the state of South Carolina. How do we honor Kayla? We honor her by advocating, fighting, and pushing for things that will make other people's pain, make it more able for them to bear it, without losing their mind in the process because they don't have answers, or alternatively, preventing that pain by addressing the issues you've heard about today with mental health in this state. All of these things are steps forward. Now, will it ensure that this kind of stuff never happens? It won't. But we can try to fix it.
Would you say the issue of your concern is less the actions of deputies and more an overall maybe broken healthcare system or lack of healthcare resources?
This situation is the result of mental health system failures in this state, and that spills over into law enforcement. It spills over into the hospitals, the mental health facilities, and it spills over and impacts the households, right? So for example, this young woman is on the schizophrenia scale. They didn't go to school for that. They don't know what that is outside of what you hear about it. And to think that no one told them who are responsible for caring for her and who want to care for her. This is not a family who had a sick person living there and just said, well, to hell with her. That happens sometimes. That's not them. They did everything they could, everything they could. Safety measures at home, etc. Trying to read paperwork, figure out medical terms. Somebody should have sat down and explained to them, these are precautions you can take in your house, etc. On the law enforcement side, right? And like I said, the investigation is still undergoing. I don't know. We don't know as of right now whether any of those deputies that responded knew that she was a mental health patient. We don't know that. Of course, that'll come out in the investigation. But how is it that in a world where most people, and it doesn't matter how liberal, how conservative you are, Democrat, Republican, black or white, most people think that law enforcement should know their community. You police us, you should know us. There's got to be a way to ensure that officers are informed when they come to a house. Something as simple as there is someone struggling with severe mental illness living here. That can be fixed. That can be fixed, and that will make a difference. You know, we've had talks, and I served on that Biden-Sanders task force trying to craft criminal justice reform legislation, right, for the White House, like how can we fix certain things? And one of the things that was tossed around is this concept of in communities. For example, in South Carolina, there are 46 counties. Why is it that in each of the 46 counties, there isn't a mental health professional that can assist first responders? There's already a state department of mental health in every county. Have someone there who can be a tool. It's unrealistic for anybody to think that law enforcement officers can be police officers, they can be mental health counselors, they can be family law counselors when a husband and wife are arguing. They need to be your friend, right? They need to be your bodyguard. They need to keep our kids safe so that shootings like what we saw in Texas don't happen, right? There ain't but so much you can put on any one profession. And right now, law enforcement officers in our state are not adequately trained to deal with mental health professionals. The system as it exists doesn't draw a distinction between someone like me, right, who if I'm doing something, I'm voluntarily doing it. You tell me to drop something and I don't, it's because I ain't going to. And someone suffering from severe mental illness who's not even processing any law enforcement commands. They're not. They don't live in reality. That is what schizophrenia is. You don't live in reality. We can enable law enforcement to not have to just be the police in that situation if there are trained mental health professionals who can come to the scene first. Law enforcement is there as backup. Mental health professional who knows how to speak to someone with schizophrenia. You can't yell at them. I know I've dealt with schizophrenic clients a bajillion times. You can't yell at them. They don't receive that. Makes them more paranoid. Makes them more agitated, right? You talk to mental illness individuals a certain way. That's not how law enforcement approaches any situation. If they show up and they see what is perceived to be a gun, they're going to yell, drop it. They're going to yell, get on the ground. They're going to yell at you. That's what they're trained to do. So there's got to be some fix here, right? If the system was improved, Kayla is still here. This press conference is not happening. This family is not in pain. And we can't change their pain. But what they want is to try and help other families so they don't have to feel it.
Are there any other words or stories, memories anyone would like to share just about the beautiful person she was?
Just go watch some of her videos. Just go watch some of her creative videos and just some of the stuff she was into, gaming, drawing.
She screamed a lot.
She had a beautiful voice, too.
Yeah.
Beautiful voice. There was a video that she filmed, I believe just 2 days before this. And I might be able to play it. I'll play it for you. And hold that for me.
Self-preservation, self-elevation, these kind of things, they deserve celebration. No hesitation, no reservation. Go for the big leagues, no regulations. Let's celebrate life, kick back and take five, and give thanks to the source that create life. To see a sunset, to see a sunrise, and see my son born with his same eyes. To see my son smile bright in every gray sky. He's growing so fast, that's why every day I give it 100, nonstop at 90. Praise the Almighty, Father anoints me. Yet tonight I'm feeling blessed, oh. Yeah, tonight me, my God's gonna guide you. Yeah, tonight I feel no stress, oh. Yeah, tonight me, my God's gonna guide you. I be rough around the edges, maybe, yes. I keep it nappy and I do what made me happy. Ain't nobody can deny me that I'm blessed. Hey. I might be rough around the edges, maybe, yes. I keep it nappy and I do what made me happy. Ain't nobody can deny me that I'm blessed. Yes, sir.
That was her. Beautiful spirit, beautiful person. And unfortunately, a lot of things went wrong. And mental illness is a sickness, you know, and we've seen instances where the system has failed time and time again to protect members of our community who are just as important as the rest of us. And we got to find a fix.